Your seats. We were about to start. Okay, I'd like to begin. I'd like to commence. Thank you for coming back on time, and we are more or less on time, and that's the way we want to keep it as we work through the day. We're moving on to what I think is a very important session, and it's going to be a presentation from Second Secretary General John Callinan of the Taoiseach's Department to give an overview of the government's Brexit planning. I think it's important because there's an insufficient, in my view, an insufficient knowledge among the general public of the degree to which these negotiations are proceeding. And I think the value of having this today is after the statements of political leaders is that it brings us right back, gives us a right up-to-date picture of where the situation is at in the government's dealings with the EU and with the EU 27. So, John, it was great pleasure. Could I invite you to take the stage? Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Tom. So I've been asked, as Thomas said, to give an overview of the government's preparation. And as the discussion this morning already has shown, this is a complex and challenging topic. And I'd like to give as thorough an overview as possible, but I've been told I only have an hour and a half, so I'll just give you the headlines. But the overall approach involves establishing our national priorities, consulting with those who are going to be affected, putting Ireland's case to all of our EU partners, and of course also pursuing the opportunities that were mentioned this morning where they arise. But let me just say a word or two first about Article 50, because I suspect never in the history of lengthy pieces of EU legislation, never have so few words been written about a topic of such monumental importance. So Article 50 we keep hearing about, which is the legislative base for everything we're about to go through. So the first point is that we're all tired of hearing no negotiation before notification. So the Article 50 notification has to be triggered by Theresa May before the formal negotiation process begins. And then we enter into a two-year maximum negotiation period. The only extension of that 2 years is if all of the member states agree unanimously to a request from the British and as well as from the EU negotiators to extend. So the departure of the UK becomes effective from whatever date is agreed in those negotiations, but with a clear caveat that if no date is agreed, then it happens 2 years after the notification letter. So that's why you keep hearing about this being a tight two-year time period. The EU negotiation priorities have already been well set out, and they are quite a narrow set of issues. Michel Barnier has highlighted four concerns. The first is the outstanding liabilities of the UK in terms of its departure. This is the size of the check, as it's called. The rights of EU citizens in the UK and vice versa, so the rights of UK citizens living elsewhere in Europe. The two EU agencies currently based in the UK, so the Banking Authority and the Medicines Agency. And finally, the geographic or border issues of Northern Ireland and Gibraltar. And then there is this somewhat vague language which says that the withdrawal negotiations must also take account of the framework for the future relationship. And almost everything we're hearing about in terms of the border, in terms of customs, in terms of trade, in terms of the economy, really belong in the context of the future relationship. So under this process then, the roles of the different actors are clear. So the European Council, the heads of government of the member states, sets out the mandate for the negotiation process. It continues to provide ongoing political oversight and ultimately the final decision amongst the member states, which is taken by qualified majority voting. But it's worth thinking about what happens if that final decision is negative, because it doesn't change the fact that the two-year departure is definitive and finite. The European Commission has the lead negotiation role, and Michel Barnier has been appointed as the chief EU negotiator and heading the task force, but again, very much on a continuous report back and oversight from the European Council. The European Parliament is a very important actor in this, and it's good to see that we have some members of the European Parliament here today, because the arrangements agreed must receive the consent of the European Parliament. And then for the member states, and of course for us, for Ireland, we will always be at the table, and this is really important. At every level, Ireland is in the room at the table, whether that's the European Council, the General Affairs Council, the other ministerial formations, CORAPER, which is the Committee of the Permanent Representatives, the ambassadors to the EU, the specific working group that's going to be established to do a lot of the detailed work. And then bilaterally, we are in very deep engagement with the EU task force, and of course the MEPs that I mentioned in their role in relation to the European Parliament. So, even before the referendum took place, the government had initiated a very extensive contingency planning exercise right across all government departments. We had hoped, I guess, that it might never be invoked, but here we are, the 23rd of June vote is the one we have, and we have since then moved on to a much deeper intensification of our work. So the first thing is that appropriate structures have been put in place. The second is that the extent of analysis and research and work into the issues has deepened. We have launched, and this today is part of it, extensive consultation procedures. We are engaging with in every possible direction, and I'll speak a little more about that in a moment. And finally then, we are trying to broaden out the communications activity around this, because as people keep saying, we need clarity, we need certainty, and yet the only thing we know is that this is complex and difficult and uncertain. And all of this work has been done to make sure that we are absolutely ready for the negotiation process when it begins. So the structures that are put in place, well, of course, firstly, the government, in the formal sense, government ultimately is the decision-making body and will take the key decisions in relation to Ireland's approach to the Brexit negotiations. Feeding into government, we have the Cabinet Committee on Brexit, also chaired by the Taoiseach, which is providing the ongoing oversight of the preparatory work. That, in turn, is supported and serviced by an interdepartmental group of senior officials representing every single government department. And that group, in turn, is interacting with each department individually, where they have set up their own internal Brexit coordination mechanisms. The Department of the Taoiseach and Department of Foreign Affairs core teams working very closely together as a kind of an engine, if you like, driving the whole project. We have set up a number of thematic working groups where we're taking people from a variety of different departments to stress test, if you like, a lot of the key issues, whether they're of the constitutional issues that have been spoken about and will be talked about today, or the economic and sectoral issues. Each of the state agencies is a very key player as well and have their own structures and processes for engaging. And finally, but by no means least, our own embassy network is heavily mobilized working on behalf of the country. So the analysis work, I mentioned the contingency framework that was done before the referendum, and we're now engaged in this much deeper dive across all policy areas, all sectoral areas, all areas of the economy to identify the risks, the challenges, the opportunities, the possible policy responses that might be needed from government, as much as the positions to be taken in the negotiation process. You have heard again this morning the headline priorities of the economy and trade, the Northern Ireland challenges, maintaining the common travel area, and Ireland's contribution into the debate on the future of Europe. This has all been underpinned by detailed research, not just within the departments, but increasingly being commissioned by external expertise. The SRI has done great work for the Department of Finance, and there are other pieces of work underway. And again, all the time assessing not just the risks and the challenges, but also the opportunities. The next element I mentioned was consultation. So each department and agency, as part of their own remit, is pursuing through their existing structures and in many cases brand new structures that have been put in place explicitly for Brexit discussions. The All-Ireland Civic Dialogue, of which this event today is a critical part, both the plenary meetings and sectoral meetings that you've been attending. And all of the findings from this work are feeding into and informing our negotiating position. The engagement that I mentioned is, in many ways, this is the complexity, because we are facing in every direction, and in every direction there are challenges for us. So we've spoke about, and we'll talk later this morning about the particular circumstances and challenges relating to Northern Ireland and the work that has been done before the election was called, working with the executive. Obviously, we have very close engagement with our colleagues in Britain. We have to work very, very closely with all of the EU member states. And finally, and by no means least, the engagement with the institutions. So just to go into these in a little detail. So we keep talking about the unique circumstances and challenges of Northern Ireland. We've done a lot of work through the North-South Ministerial Council, and we hope that we'll be able to resume that work as quickly as possible. Under the auspices of that body, an analysis of the cross-border issues and challenges has been done by the civil service, both North and South, working together. As was mentioned by the Taoiseach earlier, a set of agreed principles were arrived at the last North-South Ministerial Council, and they are certainly, we are sticking to them, they are important. We're continuing to engage with all of the political parties in the North, and of course the consultation process has a heavy all-island dimension. There is no point in pretending but that the current political situation in Northern Ireland is making this task more difficult. Engagement with Britain. So we are constantly being reminded of no negotiation without notification. Absolutely correct. But that does not mean that we should not be in close discussion and consultation with the United Kingdom. That's happening at every level. You'll be aware that the Taoiseach met with Prime Minister May very recently, or his second meeting with her since the referendum. Ministers are meeting with their colleagues on a regular basis. The British-Irish Council, as was also mentioned this morning, a useful forum for engagement. We have, independent of Brexit, increasingly elaborate structures in place for engagement, consultation, bilateral work with the British civil service, and those structures are now proving invaluable as we continue the more detailed discussions with them on Brexit issues. And again, as I say at the end, all of this work has been done while still respecting the no negotiation principle. The other EU member states, this work is ongoing and has been ongoing since the referendum result and is now intensifying as the British position becomes clearer and as we move more closely to the negotiation phase. So the Taoiseach, of course, attends the EU summits and both on the margins of those summits and separately is having bilateral meetings with fellow heads of government. The Minister for Foreign Affairs and the Minister of State for EU Affairs have had a phenomenally intensive programme of engagement with every other member state. And increasingly, other ministers with other areas of responsibility are becoming more engaged both with the Commission and with their counterparts in other member states on the Brexit debate. Our embassy network, as you would expect, is completely mobilized and engaging on a daily basis in each of the key capitals. We are simultaneously providing ongoing briefing and information services to the EU embassies in Dublin. And then an enormous program of much more detailed technical and legislative-based discussions is happening in key capitals with teams of senior officials going out and in many cases spending full days going through in great detail the issues, the challenges. And this is a two-way process because we have to keep remembering we are not the only ones facing Brexit challenges. In terms of the EU institutions, so the Taoiseach is personally engaging in a lot of detail with the presidents of each of the key institutions, the European Council, the European Commission and the European Parliament, and has met with these people and has further meetings scheduled over the next 2 weeks with all of them. Similarly, there's been very close engagement by the Taoiseach and the ministers I mentioned with Michel Barnier, the head of the task force, and that work is broadening out now to make sure that all relevant EU commissioners are being engaged and briefed and informed of our challenges. The European Parliament, I mentioned earlier, has a crucial role. It has to provide its consent to any agreed deal, so it's self-evident that they're a hugely important institution. We, at official level, are engaged in very detailed technical meetings with the task force, I suspect probably in more detail and on a more frequent basis than any other member state. We have already had about 8 detailed sessions on a range of issues with further ones planned. Again, these are bringing in the experts from the relevant government departments on our side and from the relevant commission services in Brussels working with the task force and going through in great detail all of the issues that we're concerned about. As I mentioned earlier, we are absolutely active and will continue to be fully participating in all of the relevant structures, whether they're political, ministerial, official, diplomatic. And crucially, in that work, we are influencing the preparation of the guidelines and the mandate that will ultimately be given to Michel Barnier to do his work. I mentioned the challenges of communications, and the problem of trying to communicate clarity and certainty when so much is uncertain and complex. We are increasing our activity in this. If any of you are not currently getting our email bulletins, feel free to sign up for them. So these bulletins are going out every few days with the latest information and activity. The website material has been updated constantly. You'll find frequently asked questions, increasing volumes of reports and research. And the activity in terms of engagement with the media has also been intensified, as you would expect, as this becomes closer to the Article 50 process. And then increasingly we're using social media as well to get our messages out. So just to recap in terms of the key priorities, once again, top of the list, of course, economy and trade. Secondly, our Northern Ireland challenges, the peace process, the Good Friday Agreement, the border issues. Thirdly, protecting and retaining the common travel area. And finally, participating in the work on the future of Europe and where Europe is going in the future. And that's not an issue in the negotiations process, but it's absolutely a core central issue for Ireland and for the government. And all of the time we're pursuing these, while seeking to protect, and you heard the Taoiseach say, not only what we try to do in the negotiations, but also domestically, in terms of protecting the key economic sectors, and also, as we'll hear in the afternoon, in more detail, pursuing the economic opportunities that arise. So it's a huge program of work. I hope in the few minutes I've spoken, I'll give you at least some flavor of the amount of activity that's going on. And if I could make one last comment, as I keep saying, this is challenging, it's complex, it's difficult, but it's my great privilege to be doing this work with the cooperation of an enormous amount of committed public servants, the civil servants in government departments, the diplomatic service working on your behalf abroad, and the public servants working in our state agencies. And I can assure you that under the direction of government, all of these people are batting hard for Ireland Inc. They're out there day and night promoting, protecting and advancing Ireland's interests. A lot of the work they do by its nature is not in the public glare. It's done in meeting rooms, in government buildings, in Ivy House, in meeting rooms in the capitals across Europe, in meeting rooms in the Berlaymont building and the Justice Lipsius in Brussels. But I just want to say on my behalf to them, and they are doing this work on your behalf, a big thank you, because it's a huge national effort. Thank you very much.